That is Wild West, isn't it? Don't they call the Buckaroos here? What would they call them? Joey's? Something?
Sheila. No?
Sheila's and Joey's, is that it? Okay, I'm going to stick to English, which I'm trying to get a grasp on still, so we'll just stick to that for now. This is a smidgen high. I'll probably bring that home a little bit. But amen. So grateful to be in the house of the Lord with a fountain behind me. And, you know, I don't know if you realize how much work goes into this stuff. They're painting. They're gluing. Something I need to explain to you is nothing that you see came put together. Like, well, that did. I mean, you can obviously see that did. But like, when you look at the alligators, and I don't know if you need to notice the alligator, come say hello to the alligator before you leave today. Like, when you look at the things that are put together around the building, nothing came assembled. Everything had to be glued, twisted, stapled together, painted, you know, prayed over so it wouldn't fall apart 12 times. So it's a big deal. It takes a lot of effort and a lot of work. So you know what? If you get an opportunity to thank one of the VBS workers, do so. But more importantly than that, I really want us thinking, hey, what kid can I invite? What neighbor has a child, or what nephew, or what niece, or what, who can I, God, put somebody in my heart, in my thoughts, that I can invite to this thing, amen? Because we want to, right from the get-go, we want to instill the word of God in our little ones. And we want to instill it in the hearts of the little ones that come to visit the church. Listen, the truth, you know, Andrea got saved during VBS. Think about this. When the word promises that it doesn't return void, and a little kid who lives somewhere, maybe in a household that doesn't follow the Lord, where they don't read the word of God, but they come in here and they hear a scripture and they leave, they'll go their whole life. I don't know when they'll make it to church next, but the word says it does not return void. So that thing that's been planted in that tiny little mind is permanent. That's huge. So think of some little ones that you can bring. We want to base them on the rock. Amen. We're the rock. I guess there's a theme going on. We want their life to be based on the rock. I want my life to be based on the rock. Hence today's title, Live from the Rock. And we're going to be talking about this. We're going to be talking about the greatest rock. In my opinion, one of the greatest rocks mentioned in Scripture, and that's when Jesus spoke from the Sermon on the Mount. That was a very important place. That was a very important time. So this morning, I want to jump right in. Now, I do have bad news. The bad news is that Ruben's not with us today. And as you know, Ruben's been holding the time cards up here on the front row. So he's not here, so there's no time card. And that means there's no limit. No, I'm just kidding. You'll be out of here by Monday. And Jesus talks about a lot of things in Matthew, and you'll know that that's obviously where the Sermon of the Mount is. And there's so many things that he talks about, that he preaches himself about, and they're profound. They're both practical. They're both deep and practical. And today I wanted to look at his closing words. I want to look at the last things he said while he was speaking from the Sermon on the Mount, addressing people. And these words are not just another topic he's covering. This is not just another thing Jesus was saying. This is not the subject number 8 and what he was addressing the people with. I don't know if you recall me saying this. I say it all the time. If I come into the house of the Lord and I hear a sermon preached or I read a scripture and I leave unchanged, what have I accomplished? Nothing. I have to hear it. I have to apply it. When we come into the house of the Lord, we need to leave changed, because the power of the Lord is here, and the power of the Lord can change me. But not against my will. You with me? Not against my will. If I'm fighting against what the Spirit is doing, He won't force growth into my life unless I say, God, here I am. Help me. Challenge me. Charge me. Grow me. Make me better. You know? One of my constant statements is balance, right? Excuse me. Sorry. And what I don't want is for us to be in the Lord and in the Word for so long that we become good with our excuses. We become good with excuses when we step into church sometimes. And I'm saying, listen, let the Word of God change you. And you may be thinking, you know what, Pastor, I've heard this scripture preached better than that. I've read this scripture so many times. I'm familiar with this. I'm just not with it today. You know, I'm having an off day. I'm having an off day. God understands. That's the problem. The problem is that God does understand. And he wants us to leave changed. He wants us to leave a little bit better with something more in us that we got from the Word. So, in these closing words, what Jesus is saying, we'll read it here shortly. there's a huge warning that Jesus gives them about ignoring the words that he's been preaching to them from the Sermon on the Mount. He's been speaking, and while the context of what he's saying, the warning is regarding what he said on the Sermon on the Mount, the principle of what he's saying applies to the Bible in its entirety, all the whole word this principle applies to, and that is this. Matthew chapter 7. Thank you, I appreciate that. I am a little froggy right now. Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27 says this. Excuse me. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who builds his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. To illustrate that point, you remember Katrina. You remember Sandy. Remember the storm we just recently had. Huge, massive trees, just boop, like toothpicks. Powerful, devastating, damaging. But Jesus isn't talking about physical homes. He's not talking about that kind of structure. He's painting a picture because of the power and the devastation that a storm can cause. And he's saying, it's you, you're the home. You're the house. It's this house that he's saying, where are you building it? What's it built on? He's talking about the house of your soul. And he wants you to be able to stand when the storms come. And the only way to do that seriously is to take his word and put it into practice. Pastor, this is an old message, but God put it on my heart, and that means I have to preach it. See, here's the thing. Even when I see this message, I think, well, this is kind of rudimentary stuff. Many people that we have here have been saved a long time. The problem is, we're not perfect. We're human. And therefore, it says to me when I read the word of God, that scripture is for me again and again and again and again and again, because we get busy. We get spiritual, but we get busy. So just because I know the word, it doesn't matter. Remember what the word of God said? Demons know the word better than you do. The devil knows the scriptures cover to cover. He's been around a lot longer. He doesn't know the power thereof, but he knows it. Let that not be said of me, that I know the... Let me just share this very quickly. The Bible is not a book to be studied historically. It's not a book to be studied geographically. It's not a book to be used, and God forgive me for being cantankerous, it's not a book to be used to argue with people that don't believe like you do. That's not what the Bible is for. What the Bible is for is to speak truth, to speak all of it, to speak truth, and to do so in grace and in love, and let it change people from the inside out. Because it is not a book, it is a living thing. It is the power of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Having said all that, understand, I can read the same verse 150 times. I don't care, I'm going to read it again. And every time I'm going to say, God, tell me something new. Teach me something. Show me something. Am I doing this? I read this so many times. Am I actually doing this? And every now and then, God will just, you're not doing it. You know it, but you're not doing it. So that's where I am with this. So here we go. The rain came down. I'm going to start right about in the middle. The rain came down and the streams rose and the wind blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundations on the rock. And this is themed with the rock today. We're talking about Australia, right? The outback and the rock. And we're going to be talking to the kids about this. And we want them to be on a firm foundation. We're going to be teaching them about Jesus and preaching to them about being on this rock, this structure, this foundation, right? And there's three benefits that come of somebody that will do what we're talking about. There's three benefits, there's more than that, but the three that I'm talking about that will apply to somebody who says, I'm going to read the word and I'm going to apply the word, are these. The first one is security. The first one is security. Survival during these storms. There's a security involved here that when you come to the scriptures, when you come to the word, when you read it, now, I know it's going to sound like I'm beating a dead horse, you've got to read the word. You've got to do it every day. I know that. And yet here I am preaching it, praying, God, let the Spirit touch us so that we start doing it. Because I dare say, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, that we are not all reading Scripture every day. We're not. We should be. It would change us. It would move us. It would do powerful things in this church. If we, everyone in this room said, I'm going to read the scripture every single day, things would change. Things would shift. Are we that bad? Oh yeah, we are. All of us are, including me. What do you mean? Well, I mean this. If I'm serving the Lord one way, the more I read, the more I fill myself with ammunition, with fire, with wisdom. That's what comes through the Word of God. The better I can be, the more effective for the kingdom. It's a simple notion. But security is taught by staying in the Word. We have this security, this confidence. The key benefit here is so that we're not afraid. That's benefit number one of being in the Word and applying it. There's a security, there's a confidence that comes, an unflappability, for lack of a better word, that comes when you're in the Word and it's in here. And you know, no matter what happens, remember we're talking about a storm, no matter what happens, I'm not going to panic. I'm not going to be overridden with anxiety. I saw the candidates. Did you see the candidates? Right, the Republican Party, all the candidates, and is it going to be this guy or is it going to be that guy? Or boy, that would be great if that guy comes in. And sure, we can pray in that direction. I like this guy. Oh, he sounds like he's a man of faith. Really, there's no knowing until they're in office. But there they are, and so we have this. So we get involved in these things, and that's okay. We need to be involved. We need to be prayed up. We need to be praying for them. We need to be praying for wisdom. We need to pray that God would take charge and He would direct the way that He wants to. Right? But at the end of the day. Let me go on. I'll be all by myself on this, I'm sure. In fact, let me do it from over here, because I can't imagine anybody's going to agree with me. Don't be mad. Love me when I come back. I don't care who gets elected at all. I don't care. Doesn't matter to me. Why? Because God is still God, and He will remain on the throne. And whatever happens here, He knew would happen. It's predestined to happen. We should be busy, yes. We should be praying, yes. We should be active, yes, as faith in our faith and as Christians, sure. But none of that's going to scare me, not one little tiny bit. And I'm not going to lose one wink of sleep, except for when, you know, Jaden's tap dancing on my head at 3 in the morning, which he does. I don't care about anything else. Security, that confidence. The second thing, the second benefit, if I have the Word and it's in me and I'm reading it and I'm doing it, the second benefit is strength for future storms. It saves me from being afraid of a storm. That's one. Two, it gives me strength for future storms that come. I read something once. Where's the brushes? Correct me if I'm wrong. This could be wrong, but I read something once. When shipbuilders were looking for a mast, like a really serious, gigantic mast, what they would do is they would go find the right tree, and they would clear all the other trees around it. They would cut them down, and they would leave the one that they wanted standing. So that it would be exposed to the elements, exposed to the storms, because it made them stronger. It made the tree stronger. It made it survive through those storms, and only after those storms, after a season of it, then they would go and they would cut down that tree, because now it was ready to have a sail attached and to sustain and withhold the pressure that would come from the wind that this mast had to support, right? Now that may be completely bogus, I have no idea, but I thought it was a very fitting story. So whether it's true or not, correct me later. The point is, that's what happens. The point is, I don't pray God, don't send the storm. I say, God, stay with me during it. I'm not afraid of the storm, that was one. Second thing, it's going to make me stronger when the storm comes. I don't want it not to come. I expect it to come. So as the tree continues to mature, just like we need to gain this strength that develops because of the storm. Not only do we survive through the storm, but we get better. We get better. I want to share something with you about this guy, this pastor Brian that I've talked to you about in the past, Brian Cuck. Brian is the one who lost his wife some months ago. And he also lost his leg, surgeries. He's now out of the hospital. He's now out of rehab. I see pictures of him with his family. He's smiling. He's encouraging people. He's spouting scriptures off. He's writing scriptures down on Facebook. He's not out of the woods. He's not out of the woods in terms of what they have to do still with surgeries. But I don't know if you remember this. I had asked us to pray for him, for Brian. And this man who's endured all of this, I'm not trying to make a hero of this guy. He's still just a man. But when I look at him, I think, God, I don't know what I would do if that happened to me. I'm not sure. Talk about a storm. In one accident, his wife passes away, he loses his leg. He's a pastor of this church. He could very easily look at God and get angry. He could very easily look at God and say, why did I have to face this? And yet what he's doing, he's a pillar of faithfulness and hundreds of thousands, not hundreds, not thousands, hundreds of thousands of people have written, called, and visited the church. And because of the way he's standing up, because of the way he's addressing himself in the midst of this thing that he had to go through, I don't know what I would do. I'm not sure. I pray that God would give me the strength to sustain myself. I'm not sure. I don't know. I've never faced that kind of storm. I've not lost my spouse. I've never experienced that. But because of the way he's reacting, the fruit and the blessing that he will show them, and that he will that will be gained in the kingdom because of the way that it's tremendous. It's tremendous. So not only do we, I don't want him to just survive through this. I want him to be stronger, and he is. And that's what he's doing. Now don't get me wrong, I've had problems in my life too. Never a storm like that though. But the things that have happened to me have made me stronger. That's what they do. The third thing is this. The third thing we gain is this, it's wisdom. When we face something we've never faced before, we have a better, deeper understanding of who God is and how well he can sustain me. And after facing something really difficult, we realize, wow, God is good. Even in the midst of this, that I did not know if I could tolerate it or not, God came through. And it gives us an experience and an understanding, wisdom, that we did not have prior to facing that thing. Jesus said that it's a wise person who listens and obeys his words. And the foolish person is the one that ignores him and ends up having their faith and their life crash around them. A wise person not only finds the security that we talked about, they not only gain strength to face future storms, but they gain this wisdom, and here's why this is important, this extremely valuable experience and wisdom that you have, you can use to bless someone else. And the key there is to say, God, you know what? I've suffered, I've had my hard times, but you've always been faithful, you've always come through. I'm secure, I'm not afraid, I'm stronger than I was before I faced this thing. And now I have wisdom and the understanding so that when I see somebody suffering or going through a similar thing, I can get along beside them. And I can say, you know what, you're going to be okay, I know. Amen. You're going to be okay, I know.
Yes.
As long as you are grounded on the Word of God. As long as you are in the Word. Now do you understand a little bit more of why I feel like coming to each one of your houses every day and asking you, did you read the Word today? Did you read your Bible today? I'm not going to do it. Relax. I'm not coming to your house in the morning. But the truth is, it's like food. And if you don't eat it, you will starve. What happens when you don't eat? As you can tell, I don't miss too many meals. What happens when you don't eat? You lose weight, you get sick, you get weak, you get, you know, I hope you fast. When I fast, it's a struggle for me to fast. When I do, you know, all this time goes by that I haven't eaten anything. And by a certain time, I just get real sleepy and real weak, and usually about 9:30 a.m. And then I finally break down and have a bagel or something. No, listen, you feel weak when you don't eat. The scripture's just like that. It's like water and food for a Christian. You cannot starve yourself. And then you go to church because you've been going through the motions for all these years and you think, I'm good. How are you? Fine. I'm good. Thank you. How are you? But you're starved. And you have no ammunition. And you're weak and you're sick. And your relationships are sick. And there's all kinds of problems going on. But you're not in the Word every day. You're not eating. Now, the answer to all of life's ills, the way I was raised, is food. And that carries over. That carries over. In a spiritual way, it's actually true. In a physical way, maybe not so much. What's the matter? I got a hangnail. Go eat. I mean, it didn't matter what was wrong with us. The minute we out come the pots. Right? Didn't matter what was going on. We could even fake it if we were hungry. Feeling a little faint, mother, you know. And she wasn't stupid, but she'd cook anyway at the drop of a dime. This is what food, this is what this is for us. This is what the Word of God is for us. It has to be what sustains us. Listen, I don't want to pick on Becca, but I think she's the only college student in the room. Anybody else here going to college? Anybody leave? Okay. Are you live you, here, but you're, yeah, you are too, that's right. Yes. Okay, so here, listen. college-age kids. Is there anybody else college-age kids? And some that will be soon, going to be. Kevin, I see you back there. Here's the thing. You are young enough that you may not have faced particular types of storm. It's not about if the storm will come. It's when the storm will come. It will be devastating, it will be big, and it will be not something that you want to face, but it will come. There's no question. So before that time comes, feed yourself. Get strong. You're going to face things and people and situations and all manner of difficulty. And if you haven't eaten, you're going to be weak and you're going to be sick and you're going to be susceptible. And that's the truth. But it's not just for young people. It goes across the board for us too. For us who are slightly more mature. That's how I'm going to say it. I'm not going to say the word old. There are people in this room. You've weathered a lot. You've suffered a lot. You've weathered a lot. You've experienced things. I've spoken to you. I know the things that you've had, they were tough, they were difficult. Use them. See God's faithfulness through it and then help someone else with it. Things you've experienced that you know. And you look back and you think, yeah, and even then, God was so good. God is so faithful. Use it. Let me move on. Building on the rock. Shift on here. I don't have anybody giving me a time. How are we doing? We're doing good, I think, mostly. Building on the rock. Building things is not my forte. I don't know about you, but I think IKEA is from the pit of hell. I think that the devil got a hold of someone's mind and said, you're going to create a business where people take a piece of furniture home and it has 8,000 bits in it that they got to figure out how it goes together. And then we're going to give them directions, and the directions might as well be written in Swahili if you're not good at this stuff, right? And I'm not. I am most assuredly not. So building things is not my strong suit. I even had trouble with, like, in art class. I was not artistic that way. I've always loved music. But if I did a project or something, they'd make me take it home, never bring it back, that type of thing. They signed a waiver, don't send your son back to art class. I was bad. I was just I was not good. I'm not good building something. Playing something, sure, great, it's fun. I was okay with it. But building things, just not my forte. And my wife will testify to my lack of mechanical ability. Because each time we've put together some sort of project, it has to be taken apart and done again. That's fine. But when it comes to people getting help in establishing their life and establishing it on the rock, oh, God has given me that. God has given me a heart to say, I recognize that what we do in our Christian walk, it's like we're building. It's like we're building, and it's as if each day you wake up and you seek God and you pray and you're in the Word and you do what we're talking about here today. Read it and apply it. Each day you build a little more. But on the day that you don't read your Word, or on the day that you're not in prayer and you're not in worship, then you're doing something that no contractor will ever do. He goes to that same project and you're unbuilding it. That's what you're doing when you're not in the Word. Here's the thing. It's not enough for me to say, I'm a Christian. That's what I am. I pray sometimes. I read the Word. I read the Bible sometimes. I put on Christian music and worship occasionally. I can't do that. It's as if you're standing in a stream. I'm sure you've heard this. And you're either walking with the water, because the minute you stand still, it's going to carry you. You think you're good. You're not moving. You're saying, I'm good. I'm all right. No, the water's moving you. If you're not intentionally walking in the Word and in prayer, if you're not intentionally doing this Christian thing for real, then you're going backwards. Because you're in the water of this life. And the water will move you. And you will wake up one day with issues and look around yourself and think to yourself, how did I get here? Other than the fact that you starved yourself, the water moves you. Because the people around you don't want you to be sanctified. The people around you that don't know the Lord now, they don't want you to be glorifying God. They don't want your life to honor Him. And they're not going to help you. They're going to hinder you. My friends aren't that bad. I didn't say they were. But listen to me, and I'm not trying, this is not an exercise in legalism here today. Music will mess you up. The wrong TV show will mess you up. Sorry. You say what you want. You call me legalistic all you want. If you're listening to the wrong stuff, if you're watching the wrong stuff, if you're allowing garbage to come into your into the gate of your eyes and it's sinking into your heart, it's going to damage you. It can't do anything but change you from your thinking and your perception. Years ago, you turned on the TV and you would watch a certain show. And when something came on, there was a certain degree of shock value to it. For example, Lucille Ball. They didn't even have her and her husband sleeping in the same bed, right? Because it was considered too shocking for TV. Boy, has time changed. Right? Now, we turn on the TV, and the things that ought to shock you, the things that ought to hurt you, the things that ought to make you go, oh, wow, that's obscene. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to see that. That's not helping my heart at all. But we're desensitized.
Right.
Because we're not feeding ourselves.
That's right.
And we're standing still. And the water's moving us backwards. You understand? Let me move on. In our passage, Jesus hands us these two components. There's these two components to build on this firm foundation, right, on this rock, so that we can gain the three things we just talked about. Talked about security, you know, confidence. Talked about strength and wisdom that comes from these storms. And Jesus gives us two components to it. Part one is this. It's input. In the scripture, it says, everyone who hears these words of mine, right? It's here in black and white. Everyone who hears these words of mine, hears, reads, it's coming in. The word of God is coming in. There has to be input. That's component one. First main thing. Later I'll talk about how to do that, but let's just move on from here. Actively, consistently listening to the words of Jesus, reading it yourself, putting it on tape. If you know, a lot of people work and you drive, there's scripture on CDs. I've got, you know, scripture on my phone. I just hit Matthew or whatever, and it'll read it. It'll read it right to me. I'm in the kitchen, I'm doing something, and I'm listening to the whole book of Leviticus or something. Something I might not really, you know, that's an exciting book, I know. But here's the thing, it's still valuable. So I'll put it on, Deuteronomy, whatever. I'll put it on, I'll let it play. And I'm doing something mindless, and while I'm doing something mindless, I'm listening to it. It's you version, it's easy, there's a billion apps out there. Most of us have smartphones. Now some of you might not, that's okay, there's other ways. But some of you with a smartphone, download you version, hit speak on that thing and it will read through scripture to you while you're doing something. For me, it's never building anything, I think we established that. But something else, whenever I do anything else, mindless, right? I know we're busy. I know you have a lot on your plate. I know you have a lot of work and a lot of classes and a lot of this and a lot of that. And then there's hobbies. And then, well, we feel like we have the right to spend time, leisure time, and relax a little bit. And we do. And so we cram in our fun stuff in between the things that we have to do. And we're all just so, so busy. And you know what? One of the things I mentioned before, once again, was what? Balance. And I really, if you're too busy, if you're too busy to be in church, if you're too busy to read the word, if you're too busy to pray, if you're too busy to get into worship, all of that, then you're just too stinking busy and something's wrong and you have to change it. I'm not going to candy coat this. Oh, I understand. Oh, God understands. No, he doesn't. Actually, he does. That's the problem. Because God does understand, he looks at us and he says to me personally, I've experienced this. You're spinning your wheels and you're spinning your wheels and you're spinning your wheels and you haven't spent time with me. When I came to this church, in my heart of hearts, I said, Lord, one of the things that I'm going to do when I come here is every single day, I'm going to come into this room when there's nobody here and I'm going to pray and I'm going to seek you and I'm going to worship you. Not so that I can pastor, not for that, but so that I can just know Jesus, so that he can do to me what he needs to do to me. I told you before, I'm not a nice person. Nobody say amen. But it's true. I'm not a nice person. I need the Holy Spirit. I need God to constantly just be chip away at Jimmy so that he can increase and I might decrease. I have to have that. If I don't, we're all lost. All is lost. I need that. I'm desperate for it. And you know what? That's my one prayer when I got here, that I was not going to allow myself to ever be too busy to do that. I don't care what else is going on. I will move it. I will change it. I will cancel it. I won't schedule it then. I will have my time with the Lord. Now, I know, I get that I have a luxury in this. I know that. I know that many of you would do that, but you don't have the luxury I do. I know, I get that. I get that, but listen, God is going to bless you. He's going to reward you when you say, I'm going to figure out how to get in the Word every day, how to pray every day, how to spend some time in worship with your wife, with your kids. Yeah. Folks, we are starving ourselves. Yeah. Once again, our relationships, they're sick and they're suffering and they're struggling. And we can't figure out why. And we've gone to church for so many years. You're starving yourself. That's why. The Word is not there as it ought to be. It would help you. It would feed you. It would strengthen you. Amen. It would stir things up. It would cause your faith to grow. Amen. Remember what the Word of God says. When your faith grows, you can say to that mountain, move. And it'll move. Now, I don't want it to move because it took a long time to get there. And I think it's on there with like duct tape and stuff. But you get the point. You get the point. I want my faith to grow. The only way that's going to happen is if I'm in the Word. Let me move on. If you struggle with this, and I know many people do, if you struggle with this, try this. Just try this. Just real quick, this is my two cents. Every day, read something in Psalms. Read something in Proverbs. And then start in the New Testament and just read a couple verses. You don't have to spend 3 hours in Scripture if you don't have that. I understand that. But get in the Word somewhere. Read a scripture here or there. Start in the New Testament. And when you start in the New Testament, you don't have to read the entire book. Just read till something touches you. Read a few verses and say, God, show me something here. Just show me something from these verses. I know I've reread the same scripture like 50 times before I moved on. Because for whatever reason, God wasn't done with it yet. And I kept reading it. And finally, a light would go on. And okay, all right. And then I would move on. Sometimes I've read through an entire book. Nothing's jumping out at me. So I'm just reading it and letting it soak in and listening to the story. And of course, there's always something, but nothing's stopping me. But every now and then, God will just stop me, especially when I read recently about Job and the things, and reading through Job and what he faced. Every verse or two, I'm discovering these nuggets and these insights. And I'm not going to tell you what they are. Read it yourself. That's right. I wonder if any of you thought, oh, I wonder if he's going to tell us what the nugget is. Nope, it's for you to find out. Read Job. Moving on. Just read something. Without that first component, without that input component, doesn't matter how busy we are, it has to happen. Without that input component, there can't be the second part of that verse. There can't be the second part of that verse. Because the second part of that verse is, and puts them into practice. That's the second part of the verse we just read, the output, part two here. We talk a lot about this over the past year, but I want us to go over it again. Somebody whip out your bulletin. Somebody has a bulletin? Just hold it up. Read the back of it. Real loud. At the bottom. How about we just have Ron, how about you just read it real loud?
Refreshed in worship, renewed in discipleship, engaged in evangelism.
Engaged in evangelism. I've harped on this and we've shared and we've talked and I think we're doing it. I think we share our faith. And I'm proud of many of you for the things that you do and say and all of that. The truth is that can't happen without part one, without that input. It can't. We won't be engaged in evangelism. We're not going to be able to. We're not going to be able to. If we spin our wheels and we're just trying to get out there, I'm going to talk to somebody about my faith today. Well, that's fine. Read your Bible first. Be in prayer first. Let God lead you. Let God lead you. And then, yes, be active. Then, yes, go tell somebody about Jesus. The point of our salvation is to share it. That's the point of Scripture. Not simply to listen to this. Write this down. You have room on the back of the thing. Back of it. The point of Scripture, and you're reading it, is not simply to inform. It's to transform. Remember what I said earlier? Amen. It's not historical meaning that the Scriptures are important for. It's not the geographical things that you can learn about that historical time. It's not. Those aren't the things that make it important. What makes it important is that it's changing me when I read it. It's changing me when I read it. So in my natural man, I want to be selfish or prideful or rage or whatever, lust, whatever it is in my natural man, that's who we are. But I read the Word and it changes me. It gives me strength. It gives me ability and strength to persevere, not in my own, but in the grace that Christ gives me when I read the Word. It just blossoms. The more you read, the more you pray, the more God moves in your life. It's such common math, and yet, like I said before, if I said, is everybody in here reading your Bible every day? Not a lot of people would raise their hand. Let me move on. The Bible itself says that knowledge on its own puffs up. Let me say that again. The Word of God tells us that knowledge on its own, you can know the Word cover to cover. There's atheists that do too. They know it better than you do. And it puffs up knowledge by itself. What does it mean? Well, the truth is, many times, somebody who's all puffed up with this knowledge, but they're not worshiping, their heart's not engaged, but they're puffed up with all their knowledge. Here's what happens. The storm comes, a conflict comes, and it's like taking a needle, and bink, and they're all puffed up, and they explode. They explode, they get mad, they get offended, they get we know this happens. And now somebody's disgruntled, and they're just offended, and they're not able to do what they wanted to do, and that person just, man, I can't believe he or she said that to me. Well, they just want it all her way. He just wants it all his. And we get offended and deflated because the knowledge was there, but we're not in it right now. We're not in it right now. The Spirit's not leading us because we haven't been praying. We haven't been reading the Word daily. We just know it because the knowledge is there. We read it in the past. We heard it somewhere. Maybe we heard it from Sunday school. Maybe we got it in Vacation Bible School. But we don't have an active, thriving, healthy relationship with Jesus on a daily basis. So somebody gets us with a needle and we deflate. We deflate or we erupt. We get upset. We get annoyed. This is true of every one of us. But when we have the knowledge, and with the knowledge is the Spirit of God, because I'm in prayer daily, regularly. I'm feeding myself. And then someone comes by with that needle, I'm not even going to feel it. I might feel it, I'm going to ignore it. It's not going to change my... God is still on the throne, doesn't matter to me. Remember what it does? What was that first point, one of the first benefit? Security. No fear. Hit me with a pin all you want. I'm all right with that. I know the Word. I'm not afraid. I'm not. Moving on. So here's a tough question. Does it describe you? Does it describe you? Does it describe me? That we have knowledge, but we're not in the Scripture and in prayer daily, regularly. Chase pursuing Him. We're not doing it normally. What do I do to be a person of substance? The Holy Spirit has to change me. I have to constantly be saying, God, make this Word come alive to me. Let it change. Let it transform me. Yes, not inform me. Just real quick, even as I'm speaking this, God is putting something in my heart. Don't think about somebody else. This is for you. Stop thinking about someone else. I come into church, I hear a sermon, I hear the Word. Don't think about externalizing it. Who needs this? Boy, I sure wish my cousin Beatrice was here, or whatever. If anybody has a cousin Beatrice, forgive me, I have no idea. This is for you, this is for me. This is not for the person sitting next to you. Let me move on. Young Christian, mature Christian, listen. The sermon, the Scripture, is for personal consumption. Let me read this real quick. James chapter 1, verse 22 to 25. James chapter 1, verse 22 to 25. Talks about, and I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation. Now, I don't ordinarily read from the New Living Translation, but I like the way that it's worded. James chapter 1, 22 to 25 says this about the Word. And remember, it is a message to obey, not just to listen to. Transform, not inform. Not just to listen to. If you don't obey, look at what it says, you're only fooling yourself. Verse 23, if you just listen and don't obey, it's like looking at your face in the mirror, but doing nothing to improve your appearance. Ladies, thank you for improving your appearance. Some of you should be thanking the men. If I didn't shave, eventually I would be covered in fur from here to here. If I don't shave my eyebrows, eventually it's one brow. So you're welcome. You're welcome. But the illustration is sound. The illustration is sound. If you go to work, or you go to church, or you go to a family function, whatever, wherever you go, you're going to hang out, and you're all like cattywampus, and you just got up out of bed, didn't brush your teeth, glasses crooked if you're wearing glasses, hair's all a mess, people are going to be afraid of you. It's a natural inclination to say, you look in the mirror and you go, I'm not saying, oh, you handsome devil, you. No, I'm not going to talk about pride. No, no, you look in the mirror, and just a simple illustration. You go in, you're making sure, okay, yeah. Anything coming out? Yeah, no. Yanked enough of those puppies out of there yesterday. Nose hairs, in case anybody was wondering. Yeah, okay, I don't care. It's not embarrassing to me. Oh, come on. Listen, if you pull nose hairs out, raise your hand. Be proud. But just be proud. I'm not even looking at you. I'm going to look up. Because if I don't, what's going to happen? I'm going to all kinds of crap, right? The illustration is sound. The illustration sound. It's like looking at your face in the mirror and not doing anything to improve your appearance when you read the word and you don't do anything with it. It is a waste of time. And it makes you scary looking, spiritually speaking. Use the illustration. This is what he's saying. Verse 24, move on. You see yourself, walk away, and you forget what you look like. Verse 25, but if you keep looking steadily into God's perfect law, the law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you walk away and forget what you look like, it means that even though God at some point touched you, changed you, moved you, began to transform you, he was doing good things in you, but you've walked away. It's not that you already have all you need, you've already got it. No, if you walk away, you will forget. You will lose the power God gave you. You have to be in it constantly. You have to be in the Word. You have to be in prayer all the time, actively reading it, eating it, allowing it to nourish you. Then when you walk away, you remember it. It's in there giving you power, security, strength, wisdom, giving you all that because you're allowing it to transform you. And then how does it end? And God will bless you for doing it.
Amen.
It's really rather simple. I don't know how to say it any clearer than this. Earlier I mentioned that one of the benefits of living for Christ and building your life on the foundation of his word was this wisdom that I mentioned before, wisdom. And that it was much more than knowledge. And here's the thing, the reason I'm bringing it up again is there's a lot of smart people out there. There's a lot of smart people out there. They're smarter than me. They're sharp, they're intellectuals, and they just want to argue, and they have a brain capacity that most of us only dream of. They can explain all kinds of scientific and philosophical phenomenon. That's cool, that's fine. I'm not doubting somebody for being smart. I don't have a problem with that. The problem is that in spite of their intelligence, they are not wise. I am so afraid of politics for this reason. Now, don't get me wrong. I love our people here, and I know that several of them are up in politics. They know what's going on. That's great. We need to be aware and informed, prayerfully active. I believe in all that. That is not what I'm addressing right now. It's not what I'm addressing right now. What I'm addressing is when somebody loses sight of the focus of the throne of God, but they call themselves a Christian, and they want to be real active in politics because they're intelligent, but they're not wise. So what they do is they get in there and they begin lobbying and they begin working and they begin doing these things under the name of Christianity. But if it's not God's wisdom, it's just their intelligence, you know what they end up doing? Making a mess and marking, blemishing the name of Christ because it's not done in his wisdom. You get me? There's a big difference between a smart person going to church and a dummy like me saved. Big difference. Big difference. And this is not me being prideful. This is me saying how grateful I am for grace. For grace. You could walk, I don't care who you walk through that door. You could walk Henry Kissinger through that door. I would not be afraid to talk to him about Scripture. At all. In the least. Why? Because I don't have intelligence, but I have wisdom that's come to me from the Lord. And I need that. Why? Because I'll tell you right now, again, this is not me being prideful. I eat every day, in always, everywhere. I eat every day. I have to, because if I don't, I'm afraid what tomorrow will bring to me, and I don't know how to handle it. I have to eat every day.
Amen.
Ron's looking at his watch. He's holding his watch. Oh, he's just sitting like that. Okay. See, that's me being paranoid. Okay. All right. This is ending number one, Eli. Just FYI. This is closing number one. The truth is, without being without being in scripture, without being in prayer, I promise you, you're going to make dumb choices. Forgive me for being blunt. You're going to make foolish decisions. Foolish decisions. If you're not going to read the word and you're not going to pray, you're going to make a lot of bad decisions. Me too. If you have anything serious coming up, anything you have to do, do yourself a favor. Don't sign on any dotted lines till you've prayed and read the word. Say, God, check my heart. I don't need intelligence right now. I need wisdom. Andrea and I have been faced with deals that looked great. Even houses that we might purchase or things that we might go or ministry positions that looked really good. Looked really good. And we thought, well, we'll just study all the facts. You know, you do a pros and cons list. This looks good, this looks bad. And we thought we were pretty together, pretty organized about it. And then all the way at the end of it, you begin to pray and say, God, lead us. And God is like, the answer is no. Oh, okay. Well, then let me take all of the hours worth of useless nonsense that I just did and throw it out, because I should have started with asking you. I don't need intelligence. I need wisdom.
Amen.
I need God to guide me. I don't need anything more than that. We study to show ourselves approved. Study what? The word. You can't separate it from what he's saying. To eat this, because it's alive and it will help you and it will bless you. Many of the people that I know that are in my life, my mother, my grandparents, they weren't schooled at all. I don't think they went to past third grade. You know, many of you, and years ago, school wasn't like it is today, so they weren't very learned. They didn't have a lot of education, but boy, they loved the Lord. And my little grandmother had the wisdom of Solomon. I don't know I do know where it came from. It certainly wasn't education. Why? Because she was constantly eating and drinking the word. And because of it, people from all over the town would come talk to her. Because she was one of the only Christians. Everybody else there wasn't. Many weren't. Some had religion, but they weren't saved. And she developed this reputation that you could live three towns over. Now, in the mountains of Sicily, three towns over meant it was going to take you 2 days to get there. Or more, if you were whatever. But they would go. They would talk to her because she was wise. And her wisdom didn't come from a book. It came from the Lord. Well, it did come from a book. It came from the word. That's what it came from. And that's what she had. I love that legacy. I cannot tell you enough how if you're not reading the word every day and you're not praying every day and worship, are you saying this again? Yep. And worshiping every day, I cannot tell you what you're robbing yourself of. When you turn on that TV or you open that particular book, or you turn on that particular piece of music, right away your spirit will say, no, that's bothersome. I don't want to watch this. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to see that. Let me move on. When you do that, God's going to bless you. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, doesn't matter where you are, doesn't matter what your status is, doesn't matter how educated or uneducated you are, you do that, God will bless you. And he'll use you, and he'll give you genuine wisdom. Let me wrap it up here. Ending number two, Eli. Intake without output is a false foundation. So let's switch gears and we'll do three steps and we'll close with this. We really will. Number one, hear the word. I made the point pretty clear. Intake of the word, extremely important. I think we got that. I think we talked about how to do it. The choices we make, church, personal reading, things we study and pray, things we watch, things we don't watch. That's how we're going to do intake. Read it, listen to it in the car, whatever, CD. You need to do it on purpose. You need to be very intentional about it. Number two, plan the action. Plan it. Put it in your day. Don't say, you know what, that was pretty good. I'm gonna try this. No. Look at your schedule. Look at your calendar. Break it open. Say, why am I missing church here? Why am I missing prayer here? How early do I get up to go to work? What does that mean? Then where am I going to put reading the word? I'll do it in the evening if I can't do it in the morning, or I'll get up a little earlier, but I'm so busy. Change it. You're too busy. Change it. You have to. So step two is plan the action. You got to do it. Faithful to attend service, that's all good, but you need to plan it. You need to do it on purpose. So many times things that we want to do, they die in the land of good intentions. Write it down somewhere right now. Write it down on the back, in your Bible, in the margin. Put it down on your bulletin or ingrain it in your brain right now. All the good things that we want to do, many times, they just die in the land of good intentions. Write it down. Plan it. Do it. Here's what I'm going to read. Here's what I'm going to pray. Here's what I'm going to have time to just sit and let God talk to me, because that's important too. That's important too. So, boy, that sounds like a long, long time. Doesn't have to be. Just get with God. Just get with God. Let me very quickly give you four guidelines to do this, right? It has to be something solid, something tangible, something you can actually see happening. This is what you have to do with God's word. You have to understand that you're going to start reading the word, and you're going to make something real happen here. You're giving it to God, you're going to read it, you're going to apply it, you're going to do this, something tangible. We need to do it with the understanding that, Lord, I want to love people more. I want to love you more, and I want to love people more. That's why we're doing this. So give yourself the why. That's the second thing. The third thing is something doable. As I said earlier, make it something doable. You don't have to read for 3 hours. Make it something you can do. Read the scripture for 20 minutes in the morning, and then pray at lunchtime when you have 10 minutes. And then in the evening, you know, do something else. Break it up if you have to break it up. Make it doable. Don't give yourself something that you cannot do, that you'll fail at. And finally, you might start, for example, by just listen, you know what's a great way to read the word, and not if you don't have a lot of time? Read a couple verses, memorize the verse. Just chew on the verse all day long. Maybe you don't have time to sit down and say, you know what, Pastor, I can't sit down with my Bible, like you're talking about, with a cup of coffee and my pet, whatever, and sit there for 40 minutes. I don't have that. Okay, well then look up a few verses. Look up a few verses that touch you, that move you. Start in the New Testament, like I said, and work through it. Don't jump around. Don't jump around from verse to verse, because that's inconsistent. But start somewhere. Just read a couple verses, and then memorize those verses. You may not have 40 minutes to sit there, but as you're going throughout the day, see what that verse means to you and get it in your heart. The Word of God says very clearly, the Word of God have I hidden in my heart. Why? So that I won't sin against you. What happens in reverse then? What's the reverse of that? Well, the reverse of that, if I don't have the Word of God hidden in my heart, I'm going to sin. Right? Just a couple verses, something measurable. That's the fourth one. Make it something measurable. Make it something where you can look back and you can think, you know what? Every day I'm going to just check, 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 make a little calendar, whatever. Do something tangible, something you can tell, something that you can say, yes, I've been doing my devotions. Now, you may say, that sounds like something a child would do. Okay, so let's go back to the original question. Are you reading the word every single day and praying every single day? If the answer is no, then do it like a child would do it. Talked about this earlier with the worship team. Get yourself these nice little smelly stickers. You know, remember the scratch and sniff stickers? Reward yourself. Every time you read and pray that day, put a little smelly sticker somewhere, not on your spouse. Like, put it somewhere else. Put it, you know, to remind them to do it, right? Just something measurable. Let me move on. Hear the word, plan the action, do it. Take baby steps to do it if you have to, but you have to do this. You have to do this. We have to. We have to be in the word. We have to be in prayer. Or you will not succeed as a Christian. You will suffer. You will suffer. Your decisions will be bad ones. You don't need a drill sergeant. You don't need me to be a cheerleader for you. And yet many times I do feel like God gives me a message to share, and I do feel like I have to be a cheerleader, but that's okay. What I'm saying is, You don't need someone to force you to do this. You just have to do it. Now having somebody to help you be accountable, it's good too. If you're married, tell your spouse. If you're not married, call someone. Say, hey, you know what? Once a day, text me, did you read something? What did you read? I do this with people that work for me. With people that I've had on staff with me, that work for me, every day I would text them. I would say, what did you read today? And if they hadn't read, they hated hearing their phone text sound. But you know what? It was a good thing. Tell somebody, you know what? I'm giving you license to text me every day at some point, what did you read today? And then don't lie to them. We have to do this. We have to do this. Here's my infomercial. I close with this infomercial. This is the third closing. He told me once I had multiple closings, so now I feel obligated to outline them for you. Here's my infomercial. If you want the safety and the security of knowing your life is built on this solid foundation, the wisdom, the strength, we want to face the storms. We want to face it with strength, knowing God is going to support us. We need that. If we want that, if that's what we want, if we want to be characterized as somebody that's a wise person, People at work, people that know us, you know what? Talk to her. She's wise. Talk to him. They're wise people. We want to be characterized. All of that. Then we need to stop being average Christians. Because the truth is, average Christians all over this nation, they're not reading the Word. They're not reading the Word and they're not praying. And their life is riddled with problems. And we wonder why Christians are having so many issues. Addictions. Marriage failures. Children not serving. You know, all manner. And this is not outside of the church. This is inside of the church. I'm not saying that when you begin to read the Word and you get in prayer that your life will become perfect. And that all will go rosy and never again will there be a problem. But you will face it with power. You will face it with confidence, with security, with wisdom. That's what I'm saying. Amen? I don't want to be average. We focused on verses 25 to 27. Just let me read this. Let me read this end of it. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. And that leads me to say once again, I don't care how much you know. I care how much you know him. You with me? Doesn't matter what you know. I don't care what your experience has been. I care about how much do you know him right now. How deep involved with Jesus are you? Do you love him? And if you love him, how much do you love him? Are you in relationship with him? Scale of 1 to 10, are you having an intimate relationship with Jesus or not? Let's make it real practical. Scale of 1 to 10, do you have an intimate relationship with Jesus or not? Are you in the Word? Number it yourself. Are you at a 5? Are you at a 9? You at a 7? You at a 3? You at a 1? You haven't really been reading at all or praying or... Listen, every one of us needs to aim for the 10. Every one of us. We need him. Christians, what we are, little Christs, to be like him. Well, to be like him, I have to read. I have to know what he's saying. Many times the Spirit will speak to me, but many times he won't. And I want to know what he's saying, so I keep reading, because that's what he said. It's alive. It's alive. Jesus was not like the teachers of his day, and the authority that he had came straight out of heaven. Amen? I say this because I really want to emphasize to you that you can't just shove all this aside when you leave. Remember what I started with? You're going to leave. You're going to go home. You're going to have, you know, whatever, the pot roast, whatever it is, your barbecue. And you're going to be tempted to forget about this tomorrow morning as soon as you get up early to go to work or to go to school or to go to class or whatever it is you're going to do. You're going to be very tempted to forget about this. And you're not going to crack open your Bible. And you're not going to read the Word. And you're not going to spend time in prayer. Don't do that. Don't do that. Nobody will know but you. Nobody will know but you. And maybe your spouse. And maybe your kids. Jesus was dead serious about saying, don't ignore my words. Listen to what I've said. Listen. Apply it. Apply it and you'll be blessed. The words of Jesus are the words of God. I want to close in prayer today. I'm going to ask you to just stay where you are. Close your eyes, bow your head. We're just going to close in this prayer.